worship service tonight. Tonight will be more almost like a funeral type of attitude than a worship celebration. Just a time of reflection, meditation, and as we focus on the crucifixion of Jesus Christ tonight. And we hope that the Holy Spirit speaks to you. We hope that you'll see the goodness of God through the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, and that will lead you to repentance. But thank you so much. What a great crowd we have tonight. And again, this is just going to be a very special worship service tonight. Before we start, let's open up in prayer and we'll get started. Lord, we love you. And God, we know it is the goodness of God that leads us to repentance. And Lord, I just pray that your Spirit tonight will bring to surface anything that displeases you. And God, I pray that your Spirit would just show us how much you love us as we see your Son and the sacrifice that he made on the cross for our sins, Lord. God, we know that without the shedding blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. And we know that your blood cleanses us of all of our sins. We're so thankful for that. God, we also know that it is impossible to please you without faith. And I pray that tonight, through this worship service, that our faith would grow. I pray that, God, we would diligently seek you. We know that you are the rewarder of those who diligently seek you. And we pray that, God, we would seek after you tonight, this weekend, and for the rest of our lives. God, we love you. Speak to us, Lord. Your servants are listening. And we pray and we ask all these things in your name. Amen.
Thank you, Rusty. We are glad that you are with us tonight as we take time just to slow down at the beginning of Easter weekend. And there will be a lot of celebration this weekend, especially on Sunday morning in our sunrise service, and then in our two services in here in the sanctuary. We'll celebrate the resurrection on Sunday. But one of the things that we like to do on Good Friday is we like to just slow the pace. We like to focus on the crucifixion. And really, until we understand the horrific acts that took place to Christ, what he went through on the cross as he lay down his body, as he shed his blood, we can't really understand the true weight of the resurrection. And so what we want to do tonight is to focus in on what it was that our sin cost him, and to set the stage and to right our hearts before God in just a reflective posture, not only tonight, but tomorrow and leading into Sunday morning as well. And so I'm going to walk us through really all the way going back to the Lord's Supper, to the Last Supper when Christ was with the disciples. We're going to walk from there. We're going to observe communion together. As we do so, and we're going to walk right up through John 13 all the way to 18, Matthew 26 and 27 is the equivalent Matthew passage there. And we're going to walk all the way up through the crucifixion story tonight. In fact, we'll close out our time together reading the crucifixion and listening to a powerful song on our way out to reflect on Christ's death on the cross. But let me read this passage, and what I want to ask you to do is just remain seated and listen to the words as I'm reading them, and really focus in on what is going on as Christ and his disciples have this Passover meal together as we prepare our hearts to observe the Lord's Supper or communion together as well. In John 13, we read the instance of this in John's account of the gospel in verses 1 through 20. So listen to these words. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. During supper, when the devil had already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going back to God, rose from supper. He laid aside his outer garments, and taking a towel, tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, do you wash my feet?" Jesus answered him, "What I am doing to you, you do not understand now, but afterward you will understand." Peter said to him, "You shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "If I do not wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "The one who is bathed does not need to wash except for his feet, but is completely clean. And you are clean, but not every one of you." For he knew who was to betray him. That's why he said, "Not all of you are clean." When he had washed their feet and put on his outer garments and resumed his place, he said to them, "Do you understand what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so am I. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you also should do just as I have done to you. Truly, truly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. I am not speaking of all of you. I know whom I have chosen, but the scripture will be fulfilled. He who ate my bread has lifted his heel against me. I am telling you this now before it takes place, so that when it does take place, you may believe that I am he. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever receives the one I send receives me, and whoever receives me receives the one who sent me." With a backdrop of the cross, Jesus takes his disciples into this very intentional visual lesson. He shocks them. Remember, as we talked about last Sunday, the triumphal entry when Christ comes into town, he is heralded as king. He's praised by all the crowds gathered around. They're laying robes off their backs on the path before him. They're laying palm branches down before him to ride over. They're waving them in the air. He was praised as royalty as he rode into Jerusalem. But what he does with his disciples, who clearly are beneath him in the upper room, is shocking. He washes their feet. He takes a lowly posture. He takes the posture of a servant with them. But then not only that, he calls them to live the exact same way, to serve just as he also served. As you and I proclaim to be followers of Jesus Christ, we are expected to do just that, to follow him. As such, that means that we surrender our will, our preferences, our benefit, our reputation, all for him. It's at this supper that Matthew records the detailed conversation around the disciples and Christ sharing the communion and the Lord's Supper together. But even in this solemn Last Supper, there's the pronouncement, as he mentions and Matthew records, that they will take this again together, just not on that side of death. That there will come a time when he'll take it together with them and with us in heaven, in his kingdom. When he returns and when we meet him in the air, those who are still alive and are his followers will have the Lord's Supper again with him. But then it will not be in a solemn, reflective mood as we focus on the death of Christ, but it'll be in celebration together. So I'm going to ask you, if you will, as we enter into a time where we prepare our heart to think on the words that we just read, to think about what Christ did for us as he laid down his life. Surely in that upper room, it was a solemn spirit over the places. They were wrapping their minds around what Christ is saying, that this is different, that he really is about to lay down his life for them. We invite you during this time If you've made the decision to follow Jesus Christ, as our deacons come down the aisle with a communion cup to take one of those, hold that with you until I give you instructions to take it with us. If you've not yet made a decision to follow Christ, if you have kids with you maybe that have not yet made that decision, then it's a great time to explain to them what this is. And if you've not made that decision, feel free just to let that pass right along by you. As our deacons prepare to serve, let me ask you to just prepare your hearts for this time. Go before the Lord. Thank Him for what He's done in laying down His Son's life on the cross for your sin. And spend a few minutes in reflection as we prepare to serve. If you'll go ahead and peel up the bread side of your cup and remove that bread with me. As we look at Matthew's gospel in chapter 26 and verse 6, Matthew records as the disciples were eating and were at this Passover meal together, Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat it. This is my body." And if you'll remove the lid over the juice with me. He then says, and he took a cup. After giving thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." God, we do come before you in incredible awe. As we think about you laying down your son's life for us, God, we recognize not one of us in this place tonight deserves the sacrifice that you made. God, we thank you so much for the sacrifice that your son took on the cross. God, we thank you for the fact that we read in your word that it pleased you to put him there, because it was through putting him there that you were able to receive us as sons and daughters. God, we thank you so much. As we focus our minds tonight, as we continue doing so in song and in scripture readings for the rest of this service, God, as we focus our minds on what our sin cost your son, God, we praise you as we think about those things, that what was owed to us, you took on yourself and in your son. God, help us to glorify you as we praise and thank you. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. I invite you to stand. We're going to sing hymns that focus our attention on what Christ did for us on the cross. We're going to start with Down at the Cross.
Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name, glory to his name. sorrow and love flow mingle down. Did e'er such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown? Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross bids me come and die and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross, all who gather here by grace draw near and bless your name. Were the whole realm of nature mine, that were an offering far too small. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the bids me come and die and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, the wonderful cross, all who gather here by grace draw near and bless your name.
The next portion of scripture reading comes from John chapter 16, beginning at verse 16. But prior to getting there, after the Lord's Supper, he warns them that one of them will betray him, and then he gives them a new commandment. And when he had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man is glorified, and glorified in him." And that is in 13, but then in chapter 14 begins this conversation through 14, 15, and 16. And then starting in verse 1 of 14, he says, "Let your hearts not be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me." And then he promises the coming of the Holy Spirit in that chapter. And then he tells them in chapter 15, verse 1, that he is the true vine and the Father is the true vine dresser. And he says, "If anyone abides in him, he will bear much fruit." And then he warns them that the world is going to hate them because they hated him. And then he promises that there is the work of the Holy Spirit that will come, and that one day their sorrow will turn into joy. And starting at verse 16 of chapter 16, it says, "A little while and you will see me no longer, and again a little while and you will see me." So some of his disciples said to one another, "What is this that he says to us, 'A little while, and you will not see me, and again a little while, and you will see me, and because I'm going to the Father'?" So they were saying, "What does he mean by 'a little while'? We do not know what he's talking about." Jesus knew that they wanted to ask him, so he said to them, Is this what you are asking yourselves, what I mean by saying, a little while and you will see me, and again a little while and you will see me? Truly, truly, I say to you, you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. You will be sorrowful, but your sorrow will turn into joy. And when a woman is giving birth, and she has sorrow because her hour has come, but when she is delivered, the baby, so she no longer remembers the anguish for joy that a human being has been born into the world. So also you have sorrow now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you. In that day, you will ask nothing of me. Truly, truly, I say to you, whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he will give it to you. Until now, you have asked nothing in my name. Ask, and you will receive, that your joy may be full. And I've said these things to you in figures of speech. The hour is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figures of speech, but will tell you plainly about the Father. In that day, you will ask in my name, and I do not say that I will ask the Father on your behalf, for the Father himself loves you, because you have loved me, and I have believed that I have come from God. I have come from the Father and have come into the world, and now I am leaving the world and going to the Father. His disciples said, Ah, now you're speaking plainly and not using figurative speech. Now we know that you know all the things and do not need anyone to question you. This is why we believe that you came from God. Jesus answered them, Do you now believe? Behold, the hour is coming, indeed it has come, when you will be scattered, each to his own home, and will leave me alone. Yet I am not alone, for the Father is with me. And I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Now watch this video.
I was going into the city to celebrate the Passover, and he was being led out of the city as a Passover lamb. But we didn't understand that. When I got to Jerusalem, it wasn't what I expected. There was like 10 times more people there than the last time that I'd been there to celebrate Passover, and it just seemed like the whole city was angry, like just mobs of angry people. And all of a sudden, this guard, the soldier, he grabs me. I mean, he literally just pulls me out of the crowd, and he says, for me to carry this guy's cross. If this guy's blood gets on me, it stains me, and I can't celebrate the Passover. That's the whole reason I was there. It was hard to see the man through the blood. And then our eyes met. And I knew this man was not a liar. He was not a crazy man with grand ideas. He was the Messiah. I carried what I could, but he carried most of it. We began to walk. I heard the insults that they shouted at him and now at me. I felt the spit. I felt his blood on me. They'd taken a crown made of thorns, and they smashed it on his head, and blood ran into his eyes. They laid him out on a cross, and they nailed his hands and his feet to it, and they lifted it up, and he had all of his weight on that one spike through his feet, and he would push up with all of his might and gasp for a breath to stay alive. I couldn't watch it. He did that for hours. I couldn't watch it. And I looked down, and I remember seeing my hands. My hands were stained with his blood, the blood that I thought would make me unclean. And I realized it's the blood that makes me clean. He breathed his last breath, and he died. And that was the day that I helped Jesus carry. That was the day that I helped Jesus carry my cross. He hung and died on my cross.
Was our cross. The very cross that Jesus Christ was nailed to was the cross that you and I belonged on. It was your cross that he was put on. Your body is the one, my body is the one that deserved to hang there. But he willingly took our place. Until we really understand the horror of the cross as it is what we owed to God, we cannot understand the glory of an empty tomb. And so let's not rush into Resurrection Day unprepared. Let's not bypass understanding that it was our sin that put him in the tomb. At no other point in history did God do what he did than at the death of Jesus Christ. At no other point in history did God mark that this was different by doing so many miraculous things all at once. At that moment, when Christ breathed his last, God tore the curtain in the temple that separated people from the presence of God in two from top to bottom. When Christ breathed his last at midday, it went dark. God caused darkness to come over the earth. Storms broke out. An earthquake began to happen, shook the earth. Rocks split in two. In the passage we're about to read in Matthew's account, graves opened up. And those who had died with relationship with God rose from the dead and began to walk around. Why did God so shake creation? Because what happened at that moment was different than any other moment in history. And God marked it as such. As God sacrificed his son on the cross, we prepare for Easter Sunday well when we contemplate the horrific death of Jesus Christ, the payment that he made for us. I'm going to read Matthew's account of the crucifixion. He captures a lot of what John does over several chapters in chapters 26 and 27 in his account. And so I'm going to read this and we'll close out with this. I want you to listen to these words. And as soon as I get done reading these words, Don's going to come up and sing a song that's going to take us into a time of reflection. He's just going to sing it as a solo. And what I invite you to do during this is to really consider the words that I'm reading. I'd invite you to close your eyes and listen to the song that Don sings over us. And when he completes that song, we're going to be dismissed. We're not going to have a big closing or anything, but he's going to dismiss us when he finishes the song, and we're going to go to continue to focus on for the rest of this evening and tomorrow what God did for us in sending Jesus Christ to take our place on our cross as he laid down his life. Listen to these words. When Jesus had finished all these sayings, he said to his disciples, "You know that after 2 days the Passover is coming, and the Son of Man will be delivered up to be crucified. Then the chief priest and the elders of the people gathered in the palace of the high priest, whose name was Caiaphas, and plotted together in order to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him. But they said, 'Not during the feast, lest there be an uproar among the people.' Now when Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, a woman came up to him with an alabaster flask of very expensive ointment. And she poured it on his head as he reclined at the table. And when the disciples saw it, they were indignant, saying, 'Why this waste? For this could have been sold for a large sum and given to the poor.' But Jesus, aware of this, said to them, 'Why do you trouble the woman? For she has done a beautiful thing to me. For you always have the poor with you, but you will not always have me. In pouring this ointment on my body, she has done it to prepare me for burial. Truly, I say to you, wherever this gospel is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her.' Then one of the 12, whose name was Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priest and said, 'What will you give me if I deliver him over to you?' And they paid him 30 pieces of silver. And from that moment, he sought an opportunity to betray him. Now, the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus saying, 'Where will you have us prepared for you to eat the Passover?' He said, 'Go into the city to a certain man and say to him, The teacher says, My time is at hand. I will take Passover at your house with my disciples.' And the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he reclined at the table with the 12, and as they were eating, he said, 'Truly, I say to you, one of you will betray me.' And they were very sorrowful and began to say to him one after another, 'Is it I, Lord?' He answered, 'He who has dipped his hand in the dish will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that man if he had not been born.' Judas, who would betray him, answered, 'Is it I, Rabbi?' And he said to him, 'You have said so.' As they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, 'Take and eat it. This is my body.' And he took a cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.' When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And Jesus said to them, 'You will all fall away because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee.' Peter answered him, 'Though they all fall away because of you, I will never fall away.' Jesus said to him, 'Truly, I tell you, this very night before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. Peter said to him, 'Even if I must die with you, I will not deny you.' And all the disciples said the same. And Jesus went with him to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples, 'Sit here while I go over there and pray.' And taking with him Peter and the 2 sons of Zebedee, he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, 'My soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch with me.' And going a little farther, he fell on his face and prayed, saying, 'My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will.' And he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, 'So could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Again, for the second time, he went away and prayed, My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done. He came again and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words again. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, Sleep and take your rest later on. See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed in the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand. While he was speaking, Judas came, one of the 12, and with him a great crowd, with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, The one I kiss is the man. Seize him. And when he came up to Jesus at once and said, Greetings, Rabbi, and he kissed him, Jesus said to him, Friend, do what you came to do. Then they came up and laid hands on Jesus and seized him. And behold, one of those who were with Jesus stretched out his hand and drew his sword and struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his ear. And Jesus said to him, Put your sword back in its place. For all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father, and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then should the scriptures be fulfilled that it must be so? At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds, Have you come out against a robber with swords and clubs to capture me? Day after day I sat in the temple teaching, and you did not seize me. But all this has taken place that the scriptures of the prophets might be fulfilled. Then all of the disciples left him and fled. And those who had seized Jesus led him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders had gathered. And Peter was following him at a distance as far as the courtyard of the high priest, and going inside he sat with the guards to see the end. And the chief priest and the whole council were seeking false testimony against Jesus that they might put him to death, but they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. At last, two came forward and said, This man said, I am able to destroy the temple of God and to rebuild it in 3 days. And the high priest stood up and said, Have you no answer to make? What is it that these men testify against you? But Jesus remained silent. And the high priest said to him, I adjure you by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God. Jesus said to him, You have said so. But I tell you, from now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven. Then the high priest tore his robes and said, He has uttered blasphemy. What further witnesses do we need? You have now heard his blasphemy. What is your judgment? They answered, He deserves death. And they spit in his face and struck him. And some slapped him, saying, Prophesy to us, you Christ. Who is it that struck you? Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard, and the servant girl came up and said to him, You also were with Jesus the Galilean. But he denied it before them all, saying, I do not know what you mean. And when he went out to the entrance, another servant girl saw him and said to the bystanders, This man was with Jesus of Nazareth. And he denied it with an oath, I do not know the man. After a little while, bystanders came up and said to Peter, Certainly you too are one of them, for your accent betrays you. Then he began to invoke a curse on himself and to swear, I do not know the man. And immediately a rooster crowed. Peter remembered the saying of Jesus, Before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. And he went out and wept bitterly. When morning came, all the chief priests and the elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. And they bound him and led him away and delivered him over to Pilate, the governor. Then when Judas, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he changed his mind and brought back 30 pieces of silver to the chief priest and the elders, saying, I have sinned by betraying innocent blood. They said, What is that to us? See to it yourself. Throwing down the pieces of silver in the temple, he departed and went out and hanged himself. But the chief priest, taking the pieces of silver, said, It's not lawful to put them into the treasury, since it is blood money. So they took counsel and bought with them the potter's field as a burial place for strangers. Therefore, that field has been called the field of blood to this day. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken by the prophet Jeremiah, saying, And they took 30 pieces of silver, the price of him whom a price had been set by some of the sons of Israel, and they gave them for the potter's field as the Lord directed me. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, Are you the king of the Jews? Jesus said, You have said so. But when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he gave no answer. Then Pilate said to him, Do you not hear how many things they testify against you? But he gave him no answer, not even a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. And at the feast of the governor was a custom to release for the crowd one prisoner whom they wanted. And they had then a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release for you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?" For he knew that it was out of envy that they had delivered him up. Besides, while he was still sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with that righteous man, for I have suffered much because of him today in a dream." And the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release for you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what shall I do with Jesus, who is called Christ?" And they all said, "Let him be crucified." And he said, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." So when Pilate saw that he was gaining nothing, but rather a riot was beginning, he took water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves." And the people answered, "His blood be on us and on our children." Then he released for them Barabbas, and having scourged Jesus, delivered him to be crucified. And the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole battalion before him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. Twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and put a reed in his right hand. Kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." They spit on him, took the reed and struck him on the head. When they had mocked him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him and led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. When they had crucified him, they divided his garments by casting lots. Then they sat down and kept watch over him there. And over his head they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." And two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from that cross." So also the chief priest with the scribes and elders mocked him, saying, "He saved others, he cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel, let him come down now from the cross and we will believe him. He trusts in God, let God deliver him now, if he desires him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" And the robbers who were crucified with him also reviled him in the same way. Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani?" That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And some of the bystanders hearing it said, "This man is calling Elijah." And one of them ran at once and took a sponge, filled it with sour wine, and put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink. But others said, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him." Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. And behold, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth shook and the rocks were split. The tombs also were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. Coming out of the tombs after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. When the centurion and those who were with him keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were filled with awe and said, "Truly, this was the Son of God." There were also many women there looking on from a distance who had followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering to him, among whom were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother and the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who also was a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be given to him. And Joseph took the body and wrapped it in a clean linen shroud, and laying it in his own tomb, which he had cut in the rock, and he rolled a great stone to the entrance of the tomb, and he went away.
Also reflect on the cross, and we share in Christ's suffering. When Jesus died, he died for my sins and for your sins. His wounds were my wounds, and his pain was my pain. Oh, that we may know him in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering.
A fallen and sinful life I was leading. Now why is your body torn and bleeding? It should have been my hands where the nails were. It should have been my feet where the nails were. It should have been my side that was open, my heart that was broken. It should have been my hands. It should have been my feet where the nails were. At times I am tempted to overlook your grace, thinking I'm worth the love you've given. I walk like I'm earning the right to run the race, somehow forgetting you died in my place. Still, it isn't long before I stumble. One look at the cross and I am humble. It should have been my hands where the nails were. It should have been my feet where the nails were. It should have been my side that was open, my heart that was broken. It should have been my hands. It should have been my feet. It should have been my hands where the nails were. It should have been. It should have been my a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Jesus paid it.
You are dismissed.